Tantar Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Long Reach by Michael Leese, narrated by Michael Healy. Prologue. London. The sound was barely above a whisper. The music swelled and the haunting opening of Nessun Dorma filled his senses. The picture came into focus as the camera pulled back to reveal what had been hidden. The combination of the music with the brutal reality being played out on the huge TV screen captivated the watcher. His heart was racing and his mouth was dry. He reached for a glass of water, his eyes never leaving the screen. There was a last twist. As the tenor powered towards the conclusion, his voice soaring above the orchestra, the shot pulled back again. Now the viewer could see not just the man tied to a table, but the smaller figure of a woman standing alongside him. The victim was lying on his back with a mask over his face. He was struggling hopelessly against the restraints. The woman beside him raised a hand over her head, paused, then plunged it back down in a slashing arc. The picture went black. For the briefest moment there was silence, and then the lights came back on, throwing a warm glow on the scene. The lens remorselessly tracked to reveal the face of a young woman, a contented smile on her face, as she held up a knife with blood glistening on its razor-sharp tip. The courier breathed out. It was mesmerizing, even better than he had imagined it might be. It was going to make doing business so much easier. 1. City Airport, London. His client, Maxine Dubois, was focusing on her iPad. Her expression, normally impossible to read, was rapt. She'd run the 10-minute clip twice, leaning forward each time she reached a favorite part, the tip of her tongue emerging between her lips as if tasting the air. Dubois went in for the third time. The courier relaxed a little as he allowed his mind to wander back to the moment he'd first met the pair who had put together this special performance. He needed something different, and when he discovered their work, he found a way to be introduced. At their initial meeting a year ago, the courier had known they would be right. Like him, they would only do something if they could do it perfectly. They were a contrasting pair. The knife specialist was short and pixie-like, with a mischievous smile that lit up her face. The courier noticed it didn't reach her eyes. The camera user was tall and thin, with a faintly quizzical air, as if she had missed a turn and found herself in the wrong place. Many were the victims who had died, puzzling over how they had misread the pair so badly. He'd met them for drinks at a pub in Blackfriars, the pixie soon making him splutter into his beer. Size really matters, she told him, the bigger the better. Laughing at his reaction, she had tapped her forehead. It was the size of what was between the ears that was important. In her opinion, this was an area where a lot of men were poorly equipped. Evidently, he had passed some sort of test, at least on the mental side. As for anything else, even if he had been offered, he would have declined. Business could be a pleasure, but you never mixed the two. Elegant and frosty, the Frenchwoman had a mind like a trap and not a trace of sentimentality. Those attributes had helped her create a global business from the failing family concern she had inherited at just 22 years old. Within a decade, Dubois had created a conglomerate that spanned shipping and digital media to luxury hotels and high fashion. Not only did she have an unerring ability to pick out a company with potential, she had a gift for identifying talented executives to run the businesses for her. It was a wonderfully successful formula, and she had elevated her role to the point where there was little for her to do apart from removing the odd senior manager to encourager les autres. But Dubois was bored, and heard through a friend of a contact that the courier was a man who could provide entertainment. At their first meeting, she had immediately thrown down a challenge, affecting boredom and indicating she might leave at any moment. The courier had seen through the act, understanding that this client was hiding a keen sense of anticipation. Through patient questioning, he had learned that, While Dubois had her own ideas, she expected him to provide her with alternatives. As the discussions became more detailed, Dubois had specified that she did not want to have any sort of connection to the victims. That had surprised him, since her earlier behavior led him to think she was driven by a desire for revenge, maybe against a business rival or a former lover. The revelation led the courier to what she truly wanted: to take someone who had led an ordinary life, one who would be intensely missed by her circle of loved ones. He was impressed. Not many people thought in such a simple and direct manner. He had found the victim quicker than he had expected. Anne Hudson was a young woman who volunteered at her local church to help raise money for impoverished families in the UK and abroad. The courier found her picture on a charity website. She was standing at one end of a five-woman lineup with a shy smile that suggested she hated attention. She had the sort of prettiness that is particular to healthy young women, especially ones that are blooming from pregnancy, without being truly beautiful. It took his team a day to find her. The picture was taken outside a church in Worcester Park, South London, so that was where they started. A talkative cleaner provided her name, and one phone call provided her address. Then it was just a case of doorstepping her home and waiting for her to come out, which she did, although this time with a baby in a pushchair. The website picture had been months old. They had taken their own pictures and even shot a short clip of video, which had been edited into the package that his client was going through now. Dubois was still enjoying the video clip, allowing him to study her closely. He was confident she was buying into his plan. What he needed now was for her to agree to the final price. If she wanted what he could provide, then she was going to have to pay up. 2. Tower Bridge, London. Detective Chief Inspector Brian Hooley was wearing his divorce outfit, a pair of dark blue jeans, blue cotton shirt, and light gray jacket that he had bought the day after his marriage had officially ended. If pushed, he might have admitted to being influenced by the sartorial style of a middle-aged TV presenter who fronted a motoring program. His clothes suited his burly 6-foot frame, but his tenuous hold on a large bunch of flowers and box of chocolates was doing less for his image. He looked as though he might drop them at any moment as he tried to maintain his hold while looking at his watch. He was 15 minutes early and in a dilemma. Could he turn up before the agreed time? He decided to wait a little longer, but his need for the bathroom was becoming urgent. He thought about sneaking into a nearby restaurant, but was put off because it appeared to be full of serving staff waiting to pounce on the first customers of the day. There was no way he could sneak in unobserved. Although it was a warm day, the wind blowing off the River Thames felt cold, making him shiver. He combined a sigh with a shrug as he reached a decision. He was going to be early. He had been repeatedly warned about being late, even by a few seconds. An attempted joke about sudden death as a cause of lateness had earned him a hard stare. He hustled over to his destination, an upscale apartment block on the south side of the river. It boasted fabulous views over London's financial district to the east and the London Eye to the west. He caught the eye of the security guard, who grinned in recognition. Buzzing him inside, he indicated the visitor's book with a nod of his head and watched as the Met detective filled out his name and time of arrival. Writing as slowly as he could had shaved a few more seconds off, so now he was just 8 minutes early. "That's all good, Chief Inspector. Do you want me to buzz up and let him know you're here?" Hooley returned the smile. "No, thanks, Dave. Let's make it a surprise." Since the terrible events of 12 months ago, when a guard had been murdered by a man who had come to kill Jonathan Roper, the area where he sat was now protected by security glass and conversations were through a two-way microphone. Roper had personally paid for the improvements and also made a substantial payment to the widow, ensuring she could buy a small property near her mother and leaving a little over as well. Although no one blamed him, he insisted, and with the money he had inherited from his parents, he could afford it. Hooley pressed the elevator call button. The The car was waiting, and the door opened straight away. He stepped inside and went up to the top floor, the third, where Roper owned the three-bedroom penthouse. He glanced at his watch, just 5 minutes early. Still just managing to hold on to his gifts, he pressed the doorbell. He thought he could hear shouting, but then the door opened, and Roper was there, a strange smile, almost a grimace, on his face. The detective chief inspector was thinking his colleague's thick black hair looked more unruly than usual before he was dragged sideways. In his place appeared a smaller female version of Roper, who, at 5 feet 2 inches in her bare feet, was a foot shorter than the man she had replaced. This had to be Samantha, or Sam, he assumed. Like Roper, she was very pale, her coloring contrasting with her jet-black hair and dark eyes. She had her hands on her hips and was glaring at him with such a fierce expression he took an involuntary step backwards. "Why are you here now?" she demanded. Her voice was amazingly deep for someone who shared Roper's extremely slim physique, and there was a huskiness to it he would normally associate with a smoker. But he doubted that was true, as Roper couldn't abide the smell of cigarettes. "I'm Brian Hooley. Jonathan invited—" She cut him off. "I know exactly who you are. I asked you why you are here now." This doorstep interrogation was scrambling his brain. He froze, his mouth half open. Time slowed, and then Roper reappeared, looking apologetic, and slammed the door shut. The DCI pressed his ear against the door. He could make out a fierce argument, and it was Sam's voice that was dominating. The apartment went silent, and he pulled his head back just in time as the door swung open. Roper was back. "Could you knock again in exactly 5 minutes?" The door started to swing shut, but Hooley managed to jam his shoe in the door. He handed over his gifts and said, "When you finally let me in, I will need to go to the loo." The presents were snatched away. Some people might have taken exception to such a bizarre greeting. Hooley took a steadying breath and set the timer on his phone for 4 minutes and 50 seconds. At least this was happening away from prying eyes. Not for the first time, he wondered at how life with Roper could quite suddenly take on a surreal quality with activities measured in precise amounts of time that left no margin for human error. He tried to remember the last time arriving somewhere had caused such a furor. A long-buried memory surfaced of the day he had accidentally arrived, an hour early at a girlfriend's home, only to bump into the boy leaving. He'd quite forgotten about that and wondered what the girl was doing now. Probably dreaming about the days when boys were throwing themselves at her feet. But all this over a few minutes. Roper had told him it was important he arrived on time. Now he knew that meant don't be early as well as don't be late. He couldn't help smiling. The lunch they had planned was going to be interesting, especially if Roper's girlfriend was going to remain upset with him. The alarm made him jump, but he counted to three and pressed the bell. Roper opened the door instantly. The DCI suspected he had been waiting there the whole time. He was beyond being polite. "I'll be with you in a minute," he said, shoving past and heading for the guest bathroom. He'd been to the flat many times, but never when Roper had a girlfriend. He emerged to find Roper and Sam waiting in the living room. Before he could say hello again, she nudged Roper sharply in the ribs and nodded. "Sorry," said Roper, rubbing at his side. It had been a hard dig. "Sam's flight has been altered, and she's leaving earlier than she thought. She's only got 15 minutes before she has to go, so we thought coffee here, and then she can head for Heathrow, and you and I can go on for lunch." "Don't you want to go with her and see her off? You should have rung me and cancelled. I'd have totally understood." Sam spoke. "We've done all that here, much more comfortable, if you know what I mean." She gave Hooley a surprisingly frank expression, and he felt his face warm slightly. Yes, I think I do." He supposed that anyone who went out with Roper was bound to be a little out there. The man himself was a one-off. Loyal, passionate, and capable of making breathtakingly brusque personal comments totally oblivious to the impact they might have. Only last week, in the course of work, they had needed to talk to a new forensic scientist. At the end of the interview, Roper had said to the woman, "You look a lot older than the picture you've put online." Shock, rage, and embarrassment flashed over her face, to be replaced by misery as she looked as though she was about to burst into tears. Hooley had frog-marched Roper away before he could do any more damage. Outside in the corridor, he had hissed, "How many times do I need to tell you that people get distressed if you criticize their appearance, especially if you have never met them before? That very nice lady you just upset probably likes that photograph and imagines she still looks like that. It's just a small vanity thing, and it certainly doesn't need you wading in with your size 10s. It's size 11s, actually." Roper had that mulish expression on his face, which meant he thought everyone else was being ridiculous and there was no way he was going to climb down. The DCI, worried that the woman would appear at any moment, had grabbed the younger man by the arm and pulled him towards the stairs. "Come on, let's go and get a cup of coffee." The episode exemplified Roper. It wasn't that his observations were wrong, but the way he pointed them out left a lot to be desired. He came back to the present as he realized Roper was holding up a tempting-looking bottle of lager. A drink was a very good idea, and he gave the younger man a quick thumbs up. As he took a swig, he risked a glance at Samantha. She was still looking at him through narrowed eyes, but he thought she looked less angry. Holding his hands up in an apologetic gesture, he said, "My bad. I realize I should have arrived at the right time. I expect I threw all your preparations out, which must have been very annoying." In truth, he regarded the idea of a few minutes either way as inconsequential. But with Roper, he knew that details could cause the most intense issue. A couple of weeks ago, he hadn't been paying attention when it was his turn to get the coffee. Instead of a latte, he'd given his colleague a cappuccino. Roper had reacted as if he was being handed a cup of poison, refusing to accept it. It had taken the rest of the day before they were back on speaking terms. So he was relieved as Sam broke out a wicked grin.
"There's no need to pretend you really understand. From what Jonathan has told me, you are more relaxed than most neurotypicals. A lot of people would have complained that I was overreacting and not given me the chance to calm down. What they can never get their heads around is that someone like me experiences a physical sensation when someone is late or early. It's not as bad as a nettle sting, but a bit more than an itch."
"Sounds like me when someone is slow getting their round in down at the pub." He was pleased with that, but noticed from her stony response that she wasn't. "You've been working in America, Jonathan tells me," he added quickly.
"I have, or in fact I am. I've been working with the NSA for the last 6 months and it's gone well, so they've offered me a 2-year contract based in Washington. And you know what I love most about it, apart from the work itself?" She didn't wait for him to respond. "You should see the food trucks that arrive for lunch, from every type of burger you can imagine to ceviche, Creole, and vegan. I love the food trucks. You can eat food from a different part of the world every day."
"I can imagine that Jonathan might like that, especially trying to find his favorite dish. But you two haven't had much time together. How are you coping with that?"
She shrugged. "It's not as hard as people say. We both have busy working lives, and then you can always talk on Skype or whatever. I don't suppose someone like yourself has ever tried anything other than talking, but you would be surprised by all the things you can do on a video call."
He had a horrible feeling she might just be about to go into detail and decided that was too much information. He jumped in quickly.
"What I really meant was that you had barely got to know each other before you had to leave. That can be difficult."
"Not really. You just have to be disciplined, like doing some research. I think he's the one for me, and I thought that very quickly. I told him we should see how things go, and then maybe in another 6 months, when he comes out, we can talk more and decide what we are going to do about it. We should have the data we need by then.
Data or no data, he was having trouble with how quickly this conversation had become so personal, but didn't want to say anything that might antagonize her. Then she said something that made him feel like she was reading his mind.
I totally trust Jonathan, and he totally trusts you, so that makes you one of the good guys. In fact, it makes you one of the very few good guys at all. He was very touched, but before he could reply, the phone rang. It was the guard to say Sam's Uber had arrived. She and Jonathan disappeared into the bedroom, emerging with two huge suitcases and two smaller ones for her carry-on luggage. They squeezed into the lift and made their way down, ferrying the bags out to the car where they were stowed away.
You can see why I needed a ride to the airport. I couldn't decide what to take to Washington, so I think I've packed too much, but best to be on the safe side.
She walked over to Roper and reached up to kiss him goodbye, then clambered into the back of the car, which took off straight away. Only as the car vanished from sight did Hooley realize she hadn't said goodbye to him. He looked at Roper, who was staring at the spot where the car had turned left and disappeared from view. He patted his arm.
Come on, let's get you something to eat.
3. The courier was sitting in the expensively upholstered interior of Maxine Dubois' Gulfstream G650. One of the fastest private jets you could buy, it was capable of just under the speed of sound. At around $70 million, only the seriously wealthy could opt to buy one, let alone afford the murderously expensive cost of running it. He'd been sitting here for half an hour after joining his client at London City Airport. He'd been told the plane would be departing again 45 minutes later, so, with just 15 minutes to go, he hoped she would speak to him soon. Dubois had chosen dark grey leather to cover the seats, and the courier thought he blended in well since he had chosen one of his many handmade grey pinstripe suits for the meeting. As he waited, he looked down and admired the brilliant shine on his shoes that had been applied by the Savoy's service staff overnight. The watch with which he was keeping track of the time with was an antique gold Cartier with a brown leather strap. It was one of his favorites, and he always wore it on important days. It wasn't vanity that made him spend so much effort on his appearance. It was part of the way he sought to blend in and not stand out. Today, he wanted to look like any of the bankers who swarmed through City Airport on a daily basis. When he'd boarded the aircraft, Dubois was sat towards the rear of the cabin with her back to him and her right hand held up in a mockery of greeting. He walked forward and handed over the iPad he'd taken out of a leather carry case. While she settled to watching the video clip, he moved back to the front of the plane and sat where he could keep an eye on events, but especially on Dubois. With less than 2 minutes to go, she was done. Her steward went over to her and bent down so he could hear what she said. Then he took the iPad and returned it to the courier.
Madame congratulates you on your choice.
Even though he had been expecting the outcome, he had to resist the urge to sigh with relief. He had really wanted this to work, and he wanted the money even more. A taste for high-stakes gambling meant he needed fuel for his addiction. Walking down the steps, he turned his mind away from quite how much had been riding on today. Instead, he congratulated himself on having the foresight to set up a lucrative business that saw clients hand him eye-watering sums of money in return for the opportunity to indulge dark fantasies. For Dubois, that meant the chance to get away with murder, literally. She would soon be enjoying a drama of her own devising as she watched from a ringside seat. She wasn't one for actually doing the deed, but she loved being in control. He'd begun his criminal career as an arms smuggler, ferrying weapons into the UK, making decent money, but he wanted more. The drugs business was too difficult to break into, protected as it was by ruthless gangsters, but there was still a niche space for people trafficking. As London had grown ever larger and richer,
He had spotted that demand would rise, and since his rivals were hampered by being too large to change quickly, he had made even more money. His new fortune allowed him to indulge a long-ignored creative side. Some people referred to what he provided as snuff movies, but he knew there was more to it than that. Where else could people get to act out their dreams, even if the price was a nightmare for the victims? 4.
I'm 60% sorry that she's gone and 40% pleased.
Hooley chuckled. He doubted there were many others who could describe feelings about their girlfriend in such precise percentages.
Why such a high number to be pleased? I thought you two were getting along very well.
We are, but I've never had a girlfriend before, and we've had to be together all the time. It's funny because I want to be near her, and then I want her to go away.
It doesn't seem to make sense when I think about it, and to make it really confusing when I am on my own, at first I feel better, but then I start missing her again.
Hooley was able to buy a bit of time as a waiter appeared with Roper's food order, an impressive-looking open sandwich piled high with thinly sliced rare roast beef and served with an appetizing bowl of chips, the proper English sort. The DCI noted approvingly, not those thin-cut French fries.
I hope you don't think I'm being rude by asking questions. I was just wondering how you were able to be so precise about how you feel about it.
It's simple. Sam was with me for 6 days, and it was the first time anyone has stayed at my flat. In fact, you and Julie Mayweather are the only people who have ever visited. We got on very well, so I awarded 10% for each day. That made 60%. The bit I feel sad about now, so the rest, the 40%, must be me feeling glad.
As a detective, Hooley was used to people telling him confusing stories, usually in a forlorn attempt to try and explain how they had come to be in possession of stolen property. So he was comfortable with sifting through apparently conflicting information. This had thrown him.
Look, I'm really not someone who should be handing out relationship advice, but I don't think you're the only person in the world who finds relationships a bit confusing. When emotions get involved, common sense goes out the window. At least, that's what my grandmother used to say.
The way Roper's brow furrowed made him wonder if saying common sense had been thrown out of the window was a tactical error when he was once again saved by an approaching waiter. This one had his toasted cheese sandwich. Roper polished off the last of his sandwich and neatly placed his knife and fork on the plate. He looked at Hooley.
How do you know when things are going well?
In my experience, it's that you're not being shouted at, and that's why I may not be the best person to ask.
The DCI's decision to share his office space with Roper had been straightforward. It made life easier for everyone. His younger colleague was too easily distracted when he was surrounded by people, and that was a bad thing because it got in the way of Roper detecting patterns that everyone else missed. He needed a calm environment before he could fall into the near-zen-like state he needed. It also kept him apart from the colleagues with whom he could have difficult relationships with. In the past, there had been complaints that he wasn't a team player and had an abrasive manner. While Hooley felt these issues were exaggerated and used as the basis for unfair complaints, it was obvious his partner would never be the most popular man on the squad. No one had ever accused Roper of being the life and soul of the party. Attitudes towards him had been improving since his brilliant detective work had led to breakthroughs against seemingly impossible odds. Despite this, Hooley knew it was better to keep him close and out of the bear pit. In a strange way, he had grown to enjoy some of Roper's more acerbic comments, especially those about his weight, which had finally forced him onto a diet. He was almost 28 pounds lighter, even if, as Roper frequently pointed out, he couldn't afford to take it easy as he was still too tubby for his age.
but the DCI was never going to be a poster boy for the health lobby and was pleased with what he had achieved. He thought it was many years since he had looked this good, and he was glad his stomach had shrunk in size. It was his turn to get the coffees. He plonked a black Americano in front of Roper and noticed that he was browsing through the slush fund, the DCI's personal stash of files about unsolved cases that intrigued him. He turned to these files when his live cases were going slowly. After moving in, Roper had ferreted out the files, and from that moment on, he, too, was addicted. He was good at it, closing several cases that had been open for way too long, but it also led to one of the few serious arguments between the pair when Hooley had needed to insist that live cases should take priority. At the moment, they had very little on, so the DCI was happy to talk about the past. "Seen anything you like the look of?" Roper looked up and stared blankly at Hooley before blinking rapidly and seeming to come back from some distant space. "Sorry, I was in the rainbow spectrum. Just read some stuff that didn't make a lot of sense, so I was just trying to see if there are other links around, which I think there are, but it might take a while to get it all together." Hooley nodded thoughtfully. His colleague only mentioned the rainbow spectrum when he was on the brink of some sort of breakthrough. The spectrum was Roper's own creation, and it was a method by which he mentally catalogued different pieces of information, assigning them notional values using the color of the rainbow. While it was complicated and the DCI knew he would never fully understand how it worked, it could produce amazing results.
"Well, if it stays as quiet as this, we might need you to come up with something to stop everyone going upside down with boredom." Roper pulled a face.
"I can't promise anything. You know that most of the time these things turn out to be nothing, just lots of different information without any sort of connection."
"Well, don't get my hopes up with your wild enthusiasm." He glanced at Roper. If he'd been hoping the sarcasm would have an effect, he was wasting his time. There was no response at all. He was back in the spectrum.
5. No one who knew him would accuse the courier of being a sentimental man, but in a small, secret part of himself, he had nurtured a dream about a happy childhood, one far removed from his own, that had been one long round of drink and drug-fueled abuse. He could never help wondering how his life might have turned out if he had been brought up in a family that took pride in quiet and normality. Getting up at the same time every day, the same breakfast and the same walk to school, then the return home to a loving mother who had prepared his favorite meal. After homework, she would allow him to play with friends until it was time for a bath and getting ready for bed. For some reason, just thinking about what had never been made him feel emotional, and he liked this rare moment when he loosened the emotional shackles under which he operated. The feeling had crept up on him after he arrived at the 3-bedroom, semi-detached house his team had taken over for the surveillance operation in Worcester Park. These were family homes, and generations had been brought up in them. They were quite unlike anything in which he had grown up. He was studying a house on the opposite side of the street, and at 6:45 a.m. they had seen Anne Hudson's husband, Tony, leave the property. The courier knew he was off to catch an early train into Waterloo, where a short tube ride would deposit him close to the office where he was training to be an insurance broker. At his last assessment, his boss had lavished praise on him and told him he was set for big things. That night, the man and his wife had celebrated with a bottle of wine. They rarely drank, and when the inevitable happened, they forgot to take precautions, and 9 months later, an 8-pound, 4-ounce baby girl arrived, which they called Lily. She might not have been planned, but she could not have been more loved, although maybe a bit less so after last night. The infant had been awake from midnight until 3 a.m., according to the night shift, who had been listening in on the recently installed equipment.
So the courier was not expecting to hear from Anne Hudson any time soon. He was happy to wait. He had allowed a couple of weeks here as he sought to establish the rhythms of the neighborhood. The house he had chosen was ideal for his plan. It was a long-established rental property in a street that had several others, so neighbors were used to comings and goings and paid no attention to new tenants. He kept his eye on the house opposite as he reached for the cup of jasmine tea that one of his team had just made for him. It was cold in the house, so he could see the steam rising from the drink. The unmistakable sound of a baby starting to cry came over the speakers, and he got up to walk to the back bedroom, which had its curtains tightly shut to stop anyone realizing that the room was full of monitors displaying multiple feeds from the target house. As he walked in, there was a loud howl which caused the mother to come from deep sleep to wide awake as she sat up. Another howl saw her jumping straight out of the bed and walking over to the cot where her daughter lay, her face going red with the effort of making so much noise. She scooped up Lily and took her back to bed, where she made soft noises and then offered her breast to the child, the tone of Lily's crying telling her that the tiny girl was hungry. She was soon rewarded by seeing her daughter happily feeding. Half an hour later, Lily had drifted off to sleep. The courier could see all this through the miniaturized cameras that were installed in every room of the house. The equipment was state-of-the-art and had been expertly customized to fit in with the decor of the house. You'd have needed to know what you were looking for to spot it. A few moments later, he watched the woman carefully place her daughter back in her cot and then quickly strip off her loose-fitting nightie as she went to take a shower. The camera in the bathroom offered a very clear shot of her soaping herself, and he noted appreciatively that she was in very good shape, her baby tummy slowly going down. Not that he was remotely interested from a sexual point of view, as his own tastes in that area were highly complex and did not include young women. He imagined her furious reaction had she known she was under observation. He had already come to the view that when the time came, she would fight like a lioness, or at least she would if she were given the chance. He guessed that she would have no concerns for her own safety, only that of her daughter. If they underestimated her, they would have problems, and that would never do. 15 minutes later, Anne Hudson was sitting at the kitchen table eating toast and Marmite. She had a healthy appetite, helping herself to a third slice. Not that she had any worries about gaining weight. Later today, Lily would be placed in a three-wheeled sport buggy and would be taken for an hour's run. Breakfast over, she began the daily chores and was loading a pile of baby clothes into the washing machine when the front doorbell disturbed her. It was a delivery man with a package. He watched her take it back to the kitchen, open it up, and then beam with pleasure as she saw what it was. Moments later, and the courier could see it too, as she unwittingly put the gold cufflinks and watch on display by holding them up in front of her face, creating a perfect angle for one of the cameras in the kitchen. Research had already told him it was the husband's birthday soon, so he was probably looking at the present. He turned away from the screens. At last, he was starting to feel that familiar tingle that told him events were coming to a head and soon it would be time to replace planning and watching with action. Even better, the client had today transferred the first part of the payment. It would cover all his costs, clear his debts, and leave him with enough money to get back to the gaming tables. His passion was craps, a game that required minimal skills and maximum luck, and freed him from his normal routines of paying attention to every detail, no matter how small or apparently insignificant. He loved everything about it, the way the dice felt in his hand as he gently shook them, blowing on them for luck before launching them down the table, and the muffled noise they made as they tumbled across the green baize of the gaming table. 6. Julie Mayweather had a well-hidden sense of humor. She especially loved practical jokes and had instantly spotted the potential for one now. She'd been standing in Hooley and Roper's office for almost a minute. They were both so engrossed in their research they hadn't noticed her. She was there in her role as head of the Special Investigations Unit, but at this moment she had a plan to attract their attention. Resisting the urge to grin, she brought her hands together in a loud clap. She hadn't seen Hooley jump so much since that time he had been demonstrating the use of a taser and accidentally shot himself in the foot. Meanwhile, Roper had leapt to his feet and was looking around wildly. Satisfied her work was done, she turned quickly and left, calling out, "Can you two make it to my office in half an hour?" She had recently been appointed as one of two deputy commissioners at Scotland Yard, a well-earned promotion that pushed her into the highest echelons, meaning she had needed to review her role running the Special Investigations Unit. There had been some talk of Brian Hooley being promoted behind her, but he'd fiercely resisted the idea, arguing they made a good team as it was. In the end, after a little arm-twisting, he had agreed to take up more slack if she remained to provide the strategic direction, which dovetailed so well with his old-school know-how. As she disappeared, Hooley couldn't help but smile. He knew he hadn't been had, but it was his own fault for not being aware of what was going on. The trouble with spending time with Roper was that his immersive techniques of researching cases proved highly contagious. Roper, still looking startled, ran off, shouting that he was going for coffee. "Just got time for a drink before we go in. Do you want one?" "No, thanks. I've had about 5 pints of it so far today. I won't be sleeping for the rest of the week if I have any more, and it can't be helping my blood pressure." Given that current health advice was for moderate caffeine consumption, he imagined that Roper would agree with him. But not for the first time, he was taken by surprise. "That's just nonsense. People go on about the harmful effects of caffeine, but it all depends on how you, the individual, reacts to it. It's only just after lunch now, so one more won't affect you at all." Hooley knew better than to be sucked into a conversation. "That's a very good point you make, and reassuring for someone like me who likes their coffee. But I still feel as though I am at my limit, so the answer's still no. Thanks, all the same." 25 minutes later, an agitated Roper reappeared. Things had not gone well. "There was a huge queue, and I thought I might have to come back before it was time to go." Hooley silently filed that under Roperisms, moments when his partner used language so precisely it stopped making sense. "At least you made it, so let's go." They hadn't sat down before the briefing was underway. "We've been paid the ultimate compliment of being asked for by Special Branch and the Counter-Terrorism Command. It's not often those two will both ask for assistance." She had a touch of the theatrical about her and paused for several beats before moving to the big reveal. "Ever heard of Georgi Yebedev?" Roper's hand shot into the air. There was nothing fake about it. He was quite unable to hide his enthusiasm. This had earned him the nickname Kino, as in super keen. "He's a former Russian citizen, now based in London. He's worth in excess of £10 billion, but no one is quite sure of the total, and there are questions about how he got it. What is known is that he was one of the group of Russian businessmen and Kremlin cronies who appeared in the early 1990s and grabbed a lot of the state assets following the collapse of the Soviet Union. He turned up in Britain more than 20 years ago and has since married the daughter of an English earl. They have 3 sons, all of whom are currently at Gordonstown School, where Prince Charles went. The eldest boy is said to be highly intelligent and will be going to Cambridge to study mathematics. There was an interesting development over the choice of school. It has a policy that every pupil must carry out basic communal tasks, like cleaning the lavatories. Mr. Yebedev demanded that he be allowed to send a cleaner to do the work. When that was turned down, he asked his sons to try and bribe the other boys to do it. Somehow, the matter became public, and it was later reported that the head teacher had left Mr. Yebedev in no doubt that unless his boys did what everyone else had to do, he was welcome to take them elsewhere."
The information was delivered at a clip.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.